Hello chess friends, I'm back again with another video, and this time I'm going to show a game from the recent puzzles that I have uploaded on my blog. So in the first part I uploaded total 10 puzzles, and most of these puzzles are from the games of masters from the past, and I have decided to make one video for this one game that was part of that puzzle series. So this game is from 1930 and it was played between Mir Sultan Khan and Vera Menchik. Mir Sultan Khan was British champion for 3 times. He was from British India, and after the partition of India he went to Pakistan and he died there in 1966. And Vera Menchik is probably the strongest female chess player at that time. Still she was far way below her male counterparts of that era, but she surely without any doubt was the strongest chess player at that time. And I checked ratings of both these players on Chess Matrices website, and around this time Mir Sultan Khan was rated around 2650, so he was fairly strong among the top 10-15 in the world. And Vera Menchik was not in top 100. She actually once got into the list that was later in 1931 or 32. She was ranked 44 or 45, somewhere around there, in July or June 1931 or around that time. I exactly don't remember, but she reached the rank of 45 or 50 around that, in the top 100 in the world. But she still was fairly strong, and around the time of this game she was rated most probably about 2500, so she was fairly strong at that time. You can compare her to a modern day grandmaster. So she actually was not in the elite of the chess world, but still she was strong, and she was the first official female grandmaster also. So this game was played at Scoreborough in Yorkshire, England, and actually first British Chess Federation decided to organize this British Championship event, annual event, but later they invited 6 international players and they converted this regular tournament into an international tournament. So there were a total 12 players, and 6 of them were from Britain or British Empire, considering Mir Sultan Khan. I think she was not the British citizen at that time or even later. And non-British players included Rubinstein and Tarktower from Poland, and Makozy from Hungary, and Kole, who eventually won this tournament, and he was from Belgium, and famous Grunfeld from Austria, and Ahos from Germany. And unfortunately Tarktower was ill at that time, and he was replaced by Vera. So this game was the, you can say, result of Tarktower's illness in a sense. So in the 1962 British Chess Magazine composed all these games and published a book about this thing. This book was written by Harry Golombek, probably, as it is mentioned on the chessgames.com collection page. So Vera Menchik was actually not English. She was born to English and Czech parents, and she was living in Czechoslovakia, I think, during the early part of his life, but later she came to England and she began taking lessons from Makozy, and her positional style and her middle game and end game impressed him very much. So later she became a fairly strong chess player, and she was women's world champion from 1927 to 1944, and at that time a German air raid that was very common in the World War era, in Second World War era. So in a strike she actually died at her London residence, and apart from that we don't have much information about her personal life, and so is true for Mir Sultan Khan also. And see, and he was born in 1905 in Punjab, probably in Mitha, and Punjab was the part of British India at that time, and probably Punjab was not divided as it is right now, and half of the Punjab is now in Pakistan, half of it is in India. And later, after British divided India, Sultan Khan went to Pakistan, and he probably lived rest of his life in Rawalpindi or some city around there. And this game was played on 28 June 1930, and let's have a look at the game. So e4 was played by Sultan Khan. He was playing white pieces, so e4 striking in the center, and c6 was played, going into Caro Kann defense, and we have exchange variation of Caro Kann. Bishop d3, very common move, knight c6, and here we have first surprise. Instead of regular knight f3 move, that is replied by knight f6 and castle or c3 later. Here white also can castle, that is also possible move, but c3 is also good. And then black play c6, but that was not played. What was played in the game in this position was not knight f3 but c3, so mixing up the moves a bit. And here queen c7 was played. Another better moves were suggested by Stockfish. First I calculated knight f6 as this is the Rubinstein variation of the Caro Kann exchange, so I thought let's check it out. And after bishop f4, both white and black are equal. I check this line to some depth, and they are good for both white and black, almost equal. Another and more exciting line was suggested by Stockfish actually, that starts with e5. And this is also out of book, but a sample line goes like this, and this also is almost equal for both sides. But what was played in the game was queen c7. This position, queen c7 was played, and after queen c7, knight e2, slightly odd move, e6. Bishop f4 regularly plays. Now bishop d6 is almost forced here after this bishop b3 was played, but instead taking the bishop on d6 is far better move. Actually, I calculated this with the help of engines, not only Stockfish but with some other engines also, and most of the time I think almost all engines suggested to take on d6. So let's check out the few variations. Bishop takes d6, queen take d6, knight to d2, knight to f6, and knight f3. So here both side can castle, and this is really good for both black and white. And another very interesting line was suggested by Stockfish here, and that is bishop take this d6, and here both black and white are equal with a slight bit advantage for white, but nothing special. And this is almost dead equal position, and that is why Karo Kann is considered very solid opening. You can get equality out of opening with black pieces. So this was not played in the game. What was played in the game, probably just to avoid this very equal and symmetric position, Sultan Khan played bishop g3, and this move is really very, you can say, double edge here. It is probably he was trying to open the h file for king side attack if black castles on the king side. Knight d2 was played, and after castle f4 was played, and this is a slightly dubious move. Better was knight f3. I was also thinking about this move, and here white can use the open h file for attack, but this is also very equal, but still this is slightly better than what was played in the game. F4, and here knight, this knight move is not really very good, knight h5, because it is like giving back the slight advantage you already have because of weakening move played by white like f4. So castled, and here f5 was played, and this was real bad. Instead capturing on g3 with knight is better. This line was suggested by Stockfish, and here white king can go to f2 square maybe if need is there, and then can transfer rooks to h5, and even can try to sacrifice the rook on h5 to get open position. But that was not played in the game. F5 was played, and after f5, rook c1, knight takes g3, knight takes g3, white still has open h file, queen, and this move was played, and this really is a bad move because black rooks are not connected, and it is really going to make a lot of difference if black rooks are not connected. As I said, I made this video from the puzzle collection that I published on my blog. So in one of the puzzles, this game is from one of the puzzles, and in a certain position in the end game, this unconnected rooks of black are going to create lot many problems for Vera. So let's check it out. There is another move suggested by Stockfish was Bishop D7, and I think this move is really better. This is almost slightly, even black is slightly better here, this position. This was the simple line suggested by Stockfish, and here probably black is slightly better than white with the bishop pair and better pawn structure. But Queen F7 was played in the game. Knight F3, Bishop E7, and here Queen C2 was played. But here Knight E5 is a good move because it is very dangerous to capture Knight on E5 with Knight on CE6, because that is going to create a lot of trouble for development of the C8 bishop, because it is going to, if the black white pawn reaches E5 square, and there is no way, no easy way I can say, for the C8 bishop to come out and play in the game. So Queen E8 was played. This is also a simple line suggested by Stockfish, if Queen 8 E8 is played, but still this is also almost equal. But after Queen C2, in this position, instead of both knight takes, after Knight E5, Knight takes E5 or Queen E8, here what was played was H6, and this is a very tricky move, G4, because F takes G4 is really dubious, and it clearly gives a lot of advantage to white. Many tactical possibilities that Vera may have missed. So G6 was suggested here, but and after this line, white clearly is better. Though black has a bishop pair, but both bishops are very inactive compared to white knight on f4. Knight is much better than the bishop on d7. So this really is a good position for white. But what was played in the game after this g6 g4 move was f takes g4 and knight e5. Knight takes c5 is a blunder. And what was suggested by Stockfish was Queen f6, and Queen f6 is a real good move because it prevents many tactical ideas possible after knight takes e5. It eliminates all those tactical ideas. So a simple line is like this. This is highly tactical. So white knight is not trapped here, and this line is still slightly better for white, but it is still much better compared to what was played in the game. In this position, after knight to e5, knight takes e5 was played, and after f takes e5, it is clear now that queen is under attack. So queen to e8 was played, bishop to g5, a pair of rooks are exchanged. Now both black bishops are totally dead, you can see, and black rook on a8 is also trapped. And because of this lack of development, a tactical position arised in this game. And here, this is the beginning of the puzzle. This is the puzzle position that I posted, and from here there is a mate in 6. What was played in the game was g5, and this is a bad move, but there is nothing better to suggest. And from here there is a mate in 6, maximum in 6 move white can mate black. So let's check it out. Knight g6, here king g7 was played in the game, and that probably is the best move. What happens if king takes h7 and knight goes to f8 instead of capturing the bishop? This is far better move. And here king g7, then this is a checkmate. And if king to g8, then again another checkmate. Queen goes to g6 square, and once the king moves to h8, queen captures on h6, king back to g8, and queen to h7, checkmate, because knight is supported by the rook on f8. So that is mate in 6 at max. Other possibility, here is after king g7, knight takes e7, and here there are 2-3 possible. What was played in the game was queen e7, but let's check it out. Queen f8. This is a way to survive for a few more moves. Check, and this is a checkmate. This also is less than 6 moves. Another is bishop d7, trying to connect the rook with the queen to save the back rank. So after queen here, now this check is more dangerous because it particularly forces black to capture the bishop. Black king to capture bishop on h7, there is no other legal move. Queen goes back just to make sure that when queen captures on h6 there is a check, so that is why bishop was sacrificed. And here there is no legal move. This is a checkmate. And another possibility here is queen takes e7, and that was actually played in the game. Check, king goes to h8. And this is also mate. And I think these moves were not played out in the game. After knight takes e7, probably Vera resigned in view of these forcing variations. So that is all for now. Bye bye and good day.